Welcome to Insight, today produced in partnership between Alaska Public Media and M. Oppenheim TV. Today we're chatting with Robin Dublin, Executive Director of the Alaska Botanical Garden. Robin has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Robin, for joining us today.
Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure.
So Alaska has a very, very short growing season. Talk about how you approach managing a botanical garden in this environment as opposed to other environments where you've also run organizations.
It is really different. You know, here, in addition to the daylight hours, you know, in the winter, it gets very dark and it's cold and it's icy, so it's hard for people to come out to the garden and enjoy it in the winter. In the summer, the light kicks in. It's kicking in now in March, and it will be very bright, and our growing season is intense. Our garden is actually open daylight hours, and people don't quite know what that means, but if it's around solstice and it's 11:30 at night and you'd like to walk through the garden, it's open. It's a boreal forest, and in that forest, the master plan that was designed by the people who originally created the Alaska Botanical Garden, they had a vision of a wild area where you would move along a path and come, and there would be an entryway into a garden. And here you would come into this designed, beautiful garden, and then you would move back out onto the path and meander through the woods again and come into another garden. And it's that idea of wilderness and cultivation together. And it creates a really magical interpretation of our relationship to nature. So when you come to the garden, right now only about 6 of the 110 acres is developed into formalized gardens. And our collection of plants, our permanent collection, has over 1,100 different species that are in our garden. And it's a really special place because many of the botanical gardens that most visitors are used to seeing are really heavily manicured. And here you walk along a path, and it is truly wooded with all sorts of different kinds of plants that are part of the boreal forest. And then you move into the herb garden, and it's a traditional looking herb garden, and it's beautiful, and it has all those wonderful smells that an herb garden has, and it's magical. And then you move back out and you move along into a perennial garden, and we have an annual garden that celebrates 100 years of gardening in Anchorage, and so it's very different. It has all sorts of fruits and vegetables and flowering plants that people would have planted 100 years ago.
And the approach that you take is not an approach that is about pesticides. It's not an approach that is about anything, really. How do you manage that?
Managing a northern latitude garden and making sure that it's organic, it's a tough one. The way we treat water, our cleaning supplies, everything that we use, and we go all the way into our offices. Everything that we do, we make sure that we're looking at sustainability. What is the ecological impact of this product over that product? And it's a struggle. It means that when we are looking at a construction project, what kind of wood are we using and how are we using it? And those are tough decisions. A lot of times they're expensive. If you look at our ability to grow the garden, no pun intended, but to grow the garden, we could be doing a lot more, a lot faster if we were using chemicals. But we really believe that we're stewards of the land that we have. And so it's vital that we not only do that work in a way that is sustainable, but that we communicate that to the public. Because as a gardener, you can make a choice between using natural forms of composting material, creating your own compost, you know, doing those things that are going to allow you to be more sustainable in your little spot. And so it's our obligation to provide that information and to expose people to that, because everyone is interested in growing food and growing flowers and having plants. And we might as well do it in as clean a way as we can. We're in the process of a new project. We're really excited about it. We're building a greenhouse to essentially green our garden, to green our operations. There's other pieces of sustainability within that particular structure. We've had tough decisions to make because you have to balance out sustainability with cost.
Right.
Originally, we thought we would have composting toilets, but the reality is, with the cost, we have to dig down, and digging down in a northern environment
and
that
dig
has
very, very deep. It's very expensive.
It's very expensive. But really looking at, can we heat this building using a ground source heat pump instead of natural gas or electricity or whatever other form? It's expensive. That right there is a $60,000 to $75,000 price tag. but we felt that that was really a smart way for us to heat that building over time and really have a minimum impact on the environment. So that really excites us. We look at how do we make sure that we're insulating this building in such a way that it's really efficient, that it's going to be good for growing, but that it's really efficient. And in doing that, it changes how you raise money, it changes how much money you raise, and how you approach that particular project.
And this is a capital project that you are raising money for right now.
It is, it is. And we've raised probably, I would say, 70% of the funds, and we're in the process of raising the remaining 25%. Once we're done with this project, what we'll have is a greenhouse that will allow us to do some interesting things. You know, when you talk about sustainability and you think about green, right now what we do is many of the plants that we sell in our nursery, many of the plants that we put in our garden that are annuals, those plants are coming from outside Alaska. They're being shipped here. Mm-hmm. If you think about the carbon footprint of those plants coming here, they're being shipped here.
Moving an orchid from someplace to here.
To here. When instead what we should be doing and what we'll be able to do once we have this greenhouse is take plants from our property and from elsewhere in Alaska and bring those in and grow those and use those in our gardens, make them available to Alaskan gardeners, have them be part of our permanent collection. So that's really exciting, and it radically changes our footprint overall.
When will the greenhouse open?
Ideally, it will open in the fall.
The development of this greenhouse and the ability for you to grow your own seeds and then ultimately your own plants might also afford you a earned income opportunity over time.
We hope so. That's part of our model. That is part of our model.
So you're thinking in very much conservation terms, but conservation terms with also a business sensibility in terms of assuring that the organization remains strong and healthy going into the future.
That's always something that as the executive director, you have to focus on. And it causes you to make important and difficult decisions. It causes you to look at the organization from a business perspective, which many people struggle with. When they hear nonprofit, they think, oh, you shouldn't be making money. And we need to be good stewards of the money that we make. And the more money that we bring in, the more money we can then use on our mission. You know, to me, when we're successful, if the greenhouse becomes truly successful and is able to add revenue to the organization, that revenue can then be used to support our education programs. We're currently in 8 of 11 low-income schools in Anchorage, and we've been invited to be in all 11 schools, but we simply don't have the capacity because we don't have enough of a revenue stream. So it's all really connected for us, and as the director, I have to think about those things. So it's important to balance out.
It's not only important to balance it out, but let's face it, somebody purchasing some seeds or purchasing a ticket is a voluntary act. Mm-hmm. It's a voluntary act in which they are receiving the benefit of the seeds or of being able to experience something that you offer. And they also are able to fund the next thing that they will experience, as well as the education of others.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if people think about that when they're on vacation and they land in Anchorage and they've got a few hours and they want to go see something special and they come to the garden and they pay an entry ticket. I don't think they're thinking about how that is actually a donation. But that truly is. When you pay for a ticket to a botanical garden or a museum or a zoo, that's money that organization can use to feed their programs and to pay for their staff that then support the mission. So it really is an important act that people do when they join, become a member, when they give money just as a free donation, or if they're actually paying for an event or a ticket to come in. It really does help the organization. For us, that's about 33% of our organization's income, and that's substantial. Very substantial to us.
Now, this sensibility and the management skills that have brought you to this point were acquired all across the state and from outside of the state. Talk a little bit about your own career and how you came to this point of leading the botanical garden.
I'm laughing because it's a little bit eclectic. I started as an outdoor educator, teaching people to rock climb and sail and canoe and I was an Outward Bound instructor, and I did a lot of different things in my 20s. I was a ski patroller. I learned how people learn, and my goal at that phase in my life was to teach people about themselves and the world that they lived in. And that has actually held true with all the jobs that I've had. When I first moved to Alaska, I was running wildlife education programs for the Alaska Department of Fish and Game. And I don't hunt and I don't fish. And people said, how can you teach people if you don't hunt and you don't fish? And it's because I'm trying to teach people about the world they live in and their role in conservation. I don't garden and I run a garden, but I appreciate the beauty, I appreciate the hard work and the complexity. And I want people to experience that the beauty that is the Alaska Botanical Garden, and I want them to learn. And if they're interested in gardening, they're interested in conservation, they're interested in nature, I want to help them run with that. So I've run city parks. I ran a city park in New York. I've worked with inner city kids in Washington, D.C. I've gone canoeing in the swamps of Georgia with at-risk kids from Florida. I've done a lot of different things, and all of it has taught me that it has given me an approach. I'm very collaborative when I work with people, when I work with my staff, when I work with volunteers. I mean, we're really a team, and that comes from that outdoor education and environmental education perspective. The other thing that is particularly important to me, coming from environmental education, true environmental education doesn't teach people what to think. It teaches you how to look at an issue and think about the science and think about the economy and the politics and your particular values and ultimately make a decision for yourself. When somebody's coming on vacation and they're coming to Alaska, I approach their experience with that mindset. How do I help them have an experience that helps them define their trip here and what they see and what they interpret? I'm not telling them what to think. And so it's a magical thing, and it's an approach that I use with staff. My board seems to like it. I work with them in the same way. So it's a very collaborative, open dialogue all the time.
And you're very consumer responsive. Because you have been able to work with people who have skills that you don't have, mm-hmm. adding your skills to theirs to create this great result, it gives you a type of an appreciation for what other people can experience, what other people can contribute. You're basically defining your role as being an orchestrator and an mm-hmm. enabler, as opposed to the expert in everything.
Right.
Robin Dublin, thank you so much for sharing the work of the Alaska Botanical Garden. Thank you so much for sharing the contributions of the community and your future. And thank you so much for your insights.
Oh, thank you very much. It's my pleasure. This is great.
Welcome to Insight, today produced in partnership between Alaska Public Media and M. Oppenheim TV. We are chatting with Nina Kemppel, President and CEO of the Alaska Community Foundation, which cultivates, celebrates, and sustains all forms of philanthropy to strengthen Alaska's communities. Nina has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Nina, for joining us today.
It's my pleasure.
So the Alaska Community Foundation has had a tremendous impact over the years. Talk about the origins of the organization and what you aspire to change and evolve in Alaska, in Alaska's communities.
So the origin of the Alaska Community Foundation, it was founded 21 years ago by a real visionary group of Alaskan leaders. And really the purpose was to increase philanthropy across the state. We have a fairly extensive online presence, so mm-hmm. you can kind of learn about the organization and learn about what we do in the different ways that you can structure your fund. At the Alaska Community Foundation, we're all about, it's about the donor, and we work with the donor to make sure that they set up their fund the way that it works best for them. The service we provide is we take care of all the back-end stuff, so we do all of the IRS reporting, we do all of the basically running what would be an otherwise right. independent trust. And so we take care of all the sort of details. We invest the money obviously in a larger corpus, which has great efficiencies for everyone. Mm-hmm. One of the other kind of things that we do is we actually have also 9 affiliate funds in different communities across Alaska. And so we also support them in their giving and their philanthropy. And we believe strongly that those communities know best how to give in their own communities. And so we provide support to them so that they can do just that.
So this is also respecting local knowledge. So the affiliate, mm-hmm. The affiliates is very interesting because it is one of the tools that you use to deal with the geography of Alaska, which imposes its own set of challenges.
It's important to us in Alaska because of our geographic challenges and because some of the communities that we serve are not accessible by car, and you can get there only by air or by boat. And so we work with our 9 affiliates. When we say we want to grow philanthropy statewide, we need our affiliates. They are the ones with the knowledge on the ground. They know exactly who in the community will be able to do the most with the funding that we can provide. It started in 2008 and has grown to 9, and potentially this year will grow actually to 11 affiliates. And it really was a partnership with the Rasmussen Foundation, who's the largest family foundation here in Alaska and does wonderful giving across our state. It's been a huge supporter of the Alaska Community Foundations, but also of all the nonprofits across the state. Huge impact, and they've been our partners, and together we actually provide funding for the different affiliates and help them with the grant making process. And so it's been a program that's going for about 8 years, and we've seen some fantastic success out of it, and we continue to see our affiliates grow and prosper. And it's been really a great part of my job to get to go out into each of the communities and actually be part of the affiliates and see the wonderful work that they've done, because I think they've had amazing impact across our state and helped Alaska Community Foundation actually achieve its vision and mission of trying to truly promote philanthropy and in a real meaningful and insightful way. And their kind of local knowledge has been a wonderful addition to us sort of looking at it from a statewide perspective.
One of the things that I find so fascinating and important is the demonstration of respect, that you are basically saying we are limited by our own experiences. This is not going to just be about Anchorage. This is not going to just be about me and my knowledge, or even my staff's knowledge, or my board's knowledge. This is going to be about us. Mm-hmm. And our purpose is us. And if your purpose is us, then you really bring everybody into the tent.
That is exactly right. And I think that in addition to that, the fact that we're actually stronger as a collective team than we can be independently is an important concept in the model, the affiliate model. I will actually also mention that there are several other community foundations that aren't necessarily part of the Alaska Community Foundation, but we consider them strong partners in our overall mission too. So Juneau, Bethel, and Homer, and Arctic Slope, and they all have some amount of funding, most of them have some amount of funding at the Alaska Community Foundation, but their core assets aren't all located there. But we consider them equally, important in our role of promoting philanthropy. And we all work as a collective team, and I think are all looking for kind of new and innovative ways to even work more closely together and find ways that the different affiliates, in fact, can learn from each other. And so how does the Alaska Community Foundation bring them together in a way for them to network and learn from each other and celebrate each other's great work?
You are now involved in a $50 million campaign to strengthen the organization financially for the next journey. Talk about that campaign, mm-hmm. where you are, and how people can help.
So, right now, the Alaska Community Foundation has $75 million in assets, mm-hmm. Most of which is in funds that are granted out on a regular basis.
And about 5% of that is granted out annually. Is that about right?
That's about right. So we try to, the actual true amount of funds is about $66 million, but we grant about between 4 and 5% out a year. So many of our funds are endowed funds, mm-hmm. so that those are the ones that are 5% each year,
right.
Just to adjust for inflation and for some of the management fees. But The return has been quite high at the Alaska Community Foundation, so we've done well by all of our fund holders. There are some, though, non-endowed funds, which can be given out by the donors of the funds at any time, and we encourage that, too. We have a lot of really well positioned non-endowed funds. But really, the goal of the campaign, of the capital campaign, is we want to be able to be more resilient in meeting the different Alaskan needs, whether that be, 2 years ago we had an incredible fire season. So right. We want to be able to be adjustable. Many of our funds right now are pre-designated to be funded in a certain way. So it can go to pets in this community, or it can go to basic needs in on Alaska. But what we want to be able to do is be more kind of resilient and be able to, in the way we can react to funding different causes across the state when the need arises.
So you want to strengthen yourself financially so that you can flexibly respond to community need, particularly important now where the price of oil is down and needs are becoming accentuated. You're looking for unrestricted funding. More unrestricted funding, and you want to increase your corpus by about 70%.
That's correct. So this is an endowment campaign. It's meant to be for funds that are endowed. And the thought there is that we want to create a corpus that's large enough that we know that the legacy will live on for absolutely forever. And one of the great things about a community foundation in general, whether it be Alaska or anywhere else, is once you create that corpus, it is there, and it's a fundamental part of what will be not just the next generation, but 20 generations down the road for Alaska. And right now, there's a lot of individuals who have made their had their careers here, have earned a great deal of money here, and are at the position where they can and are wanting to start to get back. So when I say we're in a $50 million campaign, technically we have raised $24.5 million of the $50 million. So we are well into it after sort of a soft launch of 2 years. The campaign goes through 2018. So it's a lofty goal given the difficult economic times, but I think people are recognizing the need that Alaska is a place that is wonderful and that they love to live and that they want to invest back into it as they can.
And what you're really doing is you're welcoming input into your philanthropy, into your approaches. So as people are interested in being effective and in leveraging your knowledge, you're actually welcoming their sensibility in this dialogue. It's really about taking the strengths that we have as a community and applying those to solutions to make everyone's life better.
You're absolutely right. I think it's about need and it's about giving. I mean, there's something about the power of giving that's pretty important to Alaskans, and we give in multiple different ways in Alaska, and each community, each culture gives differently, but there is something really powerful in the power of giving, and there's a power in serving sort of the needs of our neighbors. Alaska is not a vastly populated state. There's only 750,000 Alaskans. A third of that population is here in Anchorage, so we support one another, and that's an important part of our culture here, and it's been an important part of culture for thousands of years here.
And there are different cultures as well. Giving, as you so articulately said, there are different traditions in giving, different approaches. There are also different approaches in ensuring that that funds contributed and time contributed are well used. So you cannot just come in with a generic approach and say, this is the audit that we're going to do, and be welcome into the fold. People can shut down. They can think, well, that's fairly rude and abrupt. Sometimes that will be embraced. So talk about how you maneuver through this complexity in a way that is respectful, but also is respectful of not only the recipient's needs and ideas, but also the giver's needs and ideas?
It's a great question, and it's something that takes a lot of sort of nuance to. But I think the key to it is understanding that giving can kind of come in a lot of different ways. And when I talk to my peers at other community foundations down in the lower 48, there's a lot of talk about measuring success of community foundations by dollars raised, dollars
right.
given. And those are two important metrics. I mean, for community foundations, it is the core of what we do. But I think in Alaska, we look at it very differently as well. We look at it from the other lens, which is, you know, how are we creating new generations of philanthropists that want to give, and new generations of people who understand the value of investing in not just today's communities, but tomorrow's communities.
Well, Nina, thank you so much for your work. Thank you so much for describing the work of the Alaska Community Foundation, and thank you so much for your insights.
Thank you for having me.